Yik talk. It's the first one today. I guess you were all missing Yik. Before I start, let me acknowledge my PhD student, Andreas Rückriegel. He did a large part of this work, and he did, I think, a very good job in doing numerics and other things. He is about to finish his PhD and will be applying for postdocs. Maybe he will apply to one of you guys, I don't know. Okay, so the second thing I want to do is I want to acknowledge the SFB. It's a special research effort between Mainz, Frankfurt and Kaiserslautern. And within this project, I started collaborating with Burkhard Hillebrands. In this SFB, we always need collaboration between theory and experiment. And I was put on the experiment of Burkhard and was more or less forced to deal with Yik. So this is a unit cell of Yik. I guess we haven't seen that yet in this conference. It looks very complicated. And when I first saw it, I said, I'm not working on Yik. It's too complicated. It has more than 100 atoms per unit cell. And it's a ferrimagnetic insulator. It's not a ferromagnet. And it has many magnon bands, I think 14 or 16, I don't quite remember. Burkhard already mentioned it has a big advantage. It has very low spin wave damping. And it has a high Curie temperature, so at room temperature you have a well-ordered magnet. Now, luckily, for some purposes at least, you can work with an effective spin model which captures at least magnon dispersion in the relevant magnon band they are probing by experiments. But I should warn you, this is not good for everything. For some cases, you need to take other magnon bands into account. There is something missing here. In Burkhard's experiment, you add a microwave field, so you should add a time-dependent magnetic field. And you should add also magnon-phonon or spin-phonon interactions if you want to describe, for example, thermalization also Bose-Einstein condensation of magnons. So here's the dipole-dipole interaction. It's important. It's just as important as the exchange interaction, because in this low momentum regime, which is probed by this Bose-Einstein condensation of magnons, these two effects, they compete. And in order to get this shallow minimum in the dispersion, you need to take both of these into account. The good thing is all these parameters in this effective model are known. So you have some saturation magnetization, which basically fixes the effective spin. The exchange interaction is about 3 Kelvin, and the lattice spacing is known. You put it on the cubic lattice, and this is your effective spin model you work with. At least that's where we started from. So we are not up in issue people. I like to have a model, Hamiltonian, and then start going. And maybe it's one step more fundamental than just writing down the Landau-Lifschitz equation. But it's an effective model, I should say. And we start from this effective model, but it's a standard spin model.
And how many irons per unit cell of that effective model?
Yeah, it's a good question. I don't know. I mean, it's just my effective spin. It's 14. It's rather big. Right, it's a big spin. I should also mention, I mean, this certainly reproduces the spin wave, all the spin wave dispersions of Yik, and we actually have made comparison with the experiments of Burkhard, Hillebrands, just on this model. This model actually, if you take a closer look at spin wave interactions, it might not be sufficient. Right, so it certainly is good for the spin wave dispersion, but once you really want to know how does the spin waves really interact, what are the interaction processes, maybe also at high energies. I think you have to take, probably you have to take other magnon bands into account, which we haven't done. Okay. Now, so the experiment is done on thin films, typically a micrometer thick. The width is millimeters. And for our purpose, we work with an effective two-dimensional model where we kind of take only the spin dynamics of the modes which propagate along this film into account. This is an approximation, but we think it's okay for at least for these experiments they are doing in this in Burkhardt's group. Now here I've drawn you a sketch of this dispersion. So it's at some wavelengths there is a minimum in the dispersion, and actually the minimum appears only if the external field is applied parallel to the field. If you make the field perpendicular, then you don't have a minimum in the dispersion. And this minimum is peculiar. I mean, it's kind of, at least for me, it was kind of strange that this happens. And there are actually three effects which compete to generate this minimum. One of them is the exchange interaction. Then the dipole-dipole interaction, which pulls the dispersion down at long wavelengths, at least in this geometry here. And then there is a finite thickness of the film, which plays an important role and which actually is important to get a minimum. Right, so all these three things are important to generate this minimum. And then if you do a spin wave theory for that, using Kolstad-Primakov transformation, for example, you have to do a spin wave theory, including dipole interactions and finite thickness, which is some work to do. You know, if you want to match the spin waves in such a film, it's non-trivial to do that. And at the beginning of this collaboration, we started with this problem and tried to get a very good control of the spin wave dispersion of these Yik films. Okay, now I guess this is just briefly to make connection with Burkhardt's experiments and Demokritov experiment. I think at that time Sergei Demokritov was still in Kaiserslautern, so they did this experiment together. So basically here's a Yik film. You kind of couple microwaves into the film, and then you have Brillouin light scattering, which basically measures the Magnon number directly as a function of time and as a function of wave vector. So you, if you're interested in non-equilibrium physics, you get directly the non-equilibrium time evolution of the Magnon occupation, which is a basic quantity you would write down in the Boltzmann equation, for example. So that's very nice, and you can directly compare your theory with experiments on this Magnon occupation. The experiments are performed at room temperature, and I told you it's certainly much below the Curie temperature, so you have a well-ordered magnet, but you might wonder whether at room temperature you see quantum effects. So I will comment on that later in my talk. Okay, here are this, what you typically see. So this is a momentum-resolved measurements of the Magnon distribution. You start from some state where you prepare some initial condition. Actually, they are not sensitive to this regime. For example, they look only at one branch. But then you evolve the system, and typically after like 700 nanoseconds, you see some redistribution in momentum space, and eventually you get a strong accumulation of Magnon occupation in the minimum of the dispersion. And the interpretation so far is Bose-Einstein condensation of magnons at room temperature, and I guess Burkhardt also emphasized 2 days ago, it's a macroscopic quantum effect. That's his interpretation. So I'm going to argue a little bit against quantum. So that's my message. Now,
he's not here.
Burkhardt's not there, but he knows my talk. Okay, so he would say, okay, it's a semantic question. let me try to get my point across. So the Magnon energies in this typical experiment, they're really much, much smaller than temperature. So if you, so they probe only Magnons, which are typically a factor of 1,000, the energy is a factor of 1,000 smaller than the temperature. So if you write down a Bose function, and certainly it's a very good approximation to replace this by T over E. So it's a factor of 1,000 typically, so it's Bose statistics for the Magnon certainly doesn't play any role. So you can use classical statistics, so I call it classical value genes distribution. It's just the equipartition of energy, the classical equipartition of energy you have there. So all Magnon states are highly occupied. If you compare, for example, the distribution quantum or classical, they just you can't distinguish. There is just it's just a classical distribution of magnons. Now, the other argument why maybe
And just a sec, so the EK is measured with respect to the bottom of
Good, so so this argument is the spin is very large, spin is effective spin is around 14. So you might also say, okay, I just take replace the spins by their expectation values, and this is the magnetization. I kind of factor out a factor of S, so I have a normalized magnetization. Then I describe just the dynamics of the magnetization using Landau-Lifshitz equation we've seen several times. If you worry about quantum fluctuations, you might try a Holstein-Primakov transformation, expand in powers of 1 over S. But S is very large, and so even the leading or next to leading terms, they're controlled by this higher powers of 1 over S. And these are certainly small effects. So this is another argument why quantum fluctuations might be small, and you might try to get away just by using an effective classical equation. So that was our strategy. I should mention also, this is certainly a reduced description of the non-equilibrium dynamics. So if you want to be more quantum, you might try to do expansion in 1 over s, keep the leading or next to leading order, and then write down a quantum Boltzmann equation with a collision integral you generate from second order perturbation theory. That would be, we have done that, and it's very complicated. And to solve a Boltzmann equation beyond the simple relaxation time approximation is it's a hard numerical job. You have to solve integral equations. And so we tried, and we decided it's not worth it because the reduced description is actually quite good. Okay, now about this classical condensation. Suppose you have completely classical waves, and actually I'm going to argue, they actually can condense in a very similar way as Bose-Einstein condensation. So what you need for that is actually, you need some element of randomness. So you need somehow momentum space, somehow has to be scrambled and redistributed. And you need nonlinear effects. You need mode coupling, you need interactions. So these two ingredients are important. So what happens then is there is some mixing, turbulent wave mixing. The number of waves in the lowest mode can be growing, and the energy is transferred to higher momenta. We can describe it in terms of formally conservative Hamiltonian, and there are entropy principles which actually try to accumulate the states in the configuration which has the lowest energy, and so that you get some large scale coherent structure due to the interplay of these two effects. So this is actually well known, and I would like to mention an example from condensation of classical waves, which is condensation of light. This is from 2012. They observed kinetic condensation of classical waves in this experiment, so they made sure this was in the classical regime where the Bose function is a Rayleigh-Jeans distribution. And they actually coined the name, this is Rayleigh-Jeans condensation. So my claim is, what Burkhardt is seeing in his experiments is very similar, just with magnons. And this is a non-trivial effect. I'm not saying it's not interesting, it's just classical. Okay, so our main hypothesis is we can describe more or less all aspects in the BEC experiment using classical Landau-Lifshitz equation. So we need randomness, nonlinear mode coupling, nonlinear waves you get from Landau-Lifshitz equation. The randomness is due to thermal fluctuations, and the thermal bath is provided by phonons in the system. It's at room temperature, phonons are certainly important, and we just take the thermal bath into account. Now we were looking around. Yeah.
Could you comment on this non-Markovian?
I come to that. I can't.
You mean beyond the LLG?
Yeah, it's beyond that. I mean, I will come to.
So LLG is not
enough. Okay, I mean, I call LLG with non-Markovian damping, I still call it LLG. I mean.
Okay, but it's not Gilbert damping.
It's not Gilbert damping. Okay. No, it's not.
What's insufficient? Just call that.
Yeah, yeah. So I will come to that point later. But to answer your question, you still get a condensation if you just use Gilbert technique. But if you want to get the numbers right for Yick, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. The numbers you don't get a consistent set of numbers because all the numbers are known for Yick.
All right, just get more filling parameters, I guess.
Yeah. Well, I mean, some aspects. I mean, you get unreasonable numbers.
Okay, but you're gonna touch upon that.
Yeah. So we discovered a paper by Rossi, Heinonen, and McDonald from 2005, where actually they also used a microscopic approach to derive an effective Landau-Lischwitz type of equation with non-Markovian damping. So, and we adopted this strategy to Yick. So the starting point is you start with a Hamiltonian having one part which has a spins. Here we have the time-dependent field. And here in this Kij, we hide all the exchange coupling and the dipolar interactions. So they're all in this big matrix here.
So Peter, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Does this also solve any UV problem you have, this free non-Markovian? Because in principle, you would expect things to diverge if you integrate over all the
men. Yeah, we don't. I mean, the UV problem, we put it on a lattice. We solve this on a lattice.
Yeah, right. But some other, let's say, the energy, let's say that the dispersion evaluated in one of the lattice constants, is that might be much higher than KVP. Maybe it's not, I don't know.
Yeah, I think we only took the low energy part into account. I mean, we put a cutoff.
Yeah. Okay.
But I mean, once you have it on the lattice, you know, there's no UV problem there.
Yeah, I know, but somehow it could be that your UV cutoff is in an energy which is higher than KVP, which would make it somehow inconsistent, right?
Or yeah.
You use early genes, either way you should not use it.
Yeah, but I think the energies, you know, we are so much, the energies are so much lower than the temperature we are worried about. I mean, it's a factor of 1,000. It puts a cutoff somewhere, you know, it in our case, we never ran into a problem there.
Okay. So your results don't depend on where you put the cutoff?
Yeah, it didn't. So don't, they don't depend.
Somehow the high energy doesn't matter.
I mean, we still need modes which are, I mean, we still get a cascade of relaxation processes, right? But maybe we start at 100. I mean, as long as we are lower than temperature, the cutoff is lower than temperature, it didn't matter.
Is it so because you explicitly put pumping at some energy which is much lower than, or not?
Yeah, I mean, the pumping energy, you know, there's an amplitude of the pumping energy, which is, I think, a factor of 100 smaller than the external field. It's still smaller than the cutoff.
Yeah, right. So
Good. So now we have phonons, and actually we in previous work we really characterized the magnon phonon coupling in Yick. So there is actually a starting point is a phenomenological theory of spin phonon coupling. I think it goes back to old work by Kittel, where he kind of wrote down some phenomenology for magnon phonon coupling, and so. The leading term is where actually the stress tensor couples via some couplings to the square of the magnetization or the spin variables. So that's well known. Actually, there is a book by Gurevich and Melkov from around I think from the 1980s, where actually they even discuss the numerical values of this magnon phonon coupling. So all these values are known. So we know these values. We can look it up in a book. And it's well established. So we know all these parameters. We know the effective ion masses. We know all the parameters in this Hamiltonian. So the next step is we write down classical equations of motion for the system. So one of them is the equation of motion for the spin. We have equations of motion for the phonons. But of course, on the right-hand side, the spin variables appear, right? But the thing is, in terms of the phonon variables, this is linear, so we formally can solve for the phonons as functional of the spins. We can stick it back in here and get an effective equation of motion. It's just classical equations of motion. So in path integral language, we'll say I integrate out the phonons. I get an effective classical equation for the spins which contain the effect of the phonons. Now you see the structure here. This is what, in a certain approximation, would reduce to Gilbert damping if you just approximate this by a delta function. But it's not a delta function. We know the thing exactly just by integrating out or solving the equations of the classical equations of motion. It's complicated. It has this magnon-phonon couplings in there, has the spin variables in there, and all the parameters of the phonons. But the good thing about Yik is we know everything. We know the masses, we know the frequencies, we know the polarizations, we know the magnon-phonon couplings. So we don't do phenomenology. We just have this retarded or this damping kernel. And of course, we assume at this point that the phonons are in equilibrium. So we have a fluctuation dissipation theorem. If you do have this dissipative term, you better add a fluctuating field to satisfy the fluctuation dissipation theorem. So our stochastic magnetic field is related again, if you average over initial conditions, is related again to this damping function. Okay, that's our model. And the next step is, I should point out one more thing. I mean, this is a conventional approximation. You somehow want to get rid of this retardation approximate by a delta function. Now in this Yik, and I think Burkhardt mentioned that, there are these phonons, and they actually, the phonon modes cross the magnon modes. So this is the magnon dispersions here, and you get some crossing. Now, in the regime where these two dispersions cross, there is no separation of energy scales between magnons and phonons. So if you, they don't decouple. Right, so they have their dynamics is described by the same time scale, and if these effects play a role, you can't do this approximation, because there is no separation of time scales of magnons and phonons, and you can't really treat one of them faster than the other. That's why to get really numbers right in this experiment, we need to take this retardation into account. Okay, now. How am I doing in time? I have another 10 minutes or so, right? Okay. Now,
But you could also just include phonons, you know, in the description, right? So say, after you integrate phonons out, they give rise to retardation, or you just include phonons on equal footing with magnons.
Yeah, we haven't. But it's more complicated. I mean, numerics is more complicated. You know, we did everything on a PC, yeah, but it was advantageous to do it that way, okay. Right? I mean, if you want to solve the Landau-Lischwitz equation with this non-Markovian thing, what you do is, of course, you introduce additional auxiliary fields to reduce it again to a Gaussian white noise. That's how you do this non-Markovian dynamics numerically. You introduce extra fields, but these extra fields are not the phonons. They have to be properly chosen, and there is a big literature on that, how you do that. So just keeping,
In connection with hybridization, you're not including processes where a magnon turns into a phonon, right?
All these processes are in principle in there. Well, we have integrated the phonons out, right? But if you,
but you had in your basic Hamiltonian was always two spins.
Yeah.
And one phonon.
Yeah, right. But the spins, you know, that's this point. The spins are mainly polarized in x direction, but then we have fluctuations, right? So there is a term where S and one phonon appears. So we have actually the hybridization comes from a quadratic form, which is first order in the phonon and first order in the magnon. We do have that. But then there are all the other higher order terms which we keep. So the cubic terms and all the high, we have principle, we have all terms we have included.
Do you know if those are the dominant, that's the dominant hybridization?
Yeah, we know for example, if we keep only the hybridization term, we can actually calculate the magnetoelastic modes and compare it with Burkhardt's experiments, and it completely agrees. It perfectly agrees. Okay. We get perfect agreement at a very, very good quantitative level. Okay, so now we do this.
Question.
Yeah.
So you assume that the phonons are in the thermal equilibrium.
Yeah.
But that essentially is neglecting the back effect.
Yeah, it does. We admit. Yeah. So it might play a role. But the phonons, the magnons, if you look at the system, the magnons, there are still few magnons, right? So the magnetization is almost saturated. Maybe it's reduced by 1% by this accumulation. So we, I mean, compared to the phonon bath, it could be that the phonon bath is still bigger than the magnons, right? But I admit it's a weak point, right? And
it is much bigger, isn't it? I mean, the heat capacity of the phonon is
huge, 100 times.
Yeah. Good, but I mean, there are some effects where this might be a play a role, that the phonons are also driven out of equilibrium, but Okay, so we identify from this parametrization, we identify the magnon occupation, and we can also show, like, if you assume thermal equilibrium of the magnons, you get this Rayleigh-Jeans distribution. And at the end of the day, you get a non-Markovian effective Landau-Lischwitz-Hilbert equation with memory for this variable m, which actually allows us to calculate the magnon occupation. Now, we put it on the computer, and again, there are some tricks to do, but some tricks also Andreas Rückriegel invented to make this work on a PC. But we didn't, at this point, we thought it's not worth it going to build our computers. We do it in our office on a PC. And of course, it's pushing the limits, and we wrote this program by ourselves. Actually, Andreas Rückriegel was the main contribution to writing this program, but it took more than a year to make it work. But at the end, we got doable results on a PC. Let me just summarize here the main results. Now, this is a time evolution of the magnon, of this occupation number of the magnons as a function of momenta in a two-dimensional Brillouin zone, as a function of time. At t equals zero, we start with a fully saturated ferromagnet and then switch on the pumping. So once you switch on the pumping, there are several stages of the time evolution. This is the earliest stage, and you see an occupation in a certain regime in momentum space. And if you look at the magnon-phonon hybridization as the magnetoelastic modes, the first stage is actually the magnetoelastic modes are occupied. So if you switch on the pumping, first there is some occupation of the magnetoelastic modes. That's the points in momentum space where magnons and phonons cross. This is first occupied. And of course, this you wouldn't get if you would do some simple kind of delta Gauss white noise or Gilbert damping, right? Then if you wait longer, this kind of, you know, you should also note the scales are here different to show this. If you wait longer, then you get a different distribution in momentum space. And actually, also this can be, has a simple interpretation. There's this phenomenon of parametric resonance in the system. You have some external field, and there are modes which satisfy this parametric resonance condition, and then you get an exponential growth of the occupation in this parametric resonance magnons. So this is this here, it's already a factor of 150, this is a factor of 0.4 here, relative. So you this is parametric pumping, which Demokritov and also Burkhardt and Alexander Selger used to generate, to pump magnons into the system. So this is a parametric resonance. But the parametric resonance, you can, you know, the exponential growth, you can describe in linear spin wave theory. But at some point, the occupation saturates. You get a saturation effect, which is due to spin wave interactions. And of course, this effect is included here. At some point, it saturates, and then you get a complicated redistribution in momentum space. This is this plot here. And if you wait longer, eventually, you kind of condense into the state with the lowest energy. This is just a state where you have a minimum in the dispersion. And this is like 350 nanoseconds. I think in this typical system, also what Burkhardt mentions, the typical lifetime of magnets is 700 nanoseconds or something like that. Yeah?
So do you have the pumping on throughout this?
It's on. Pumping is on all the time. So it's a driven, you know, it's a driven condensation. So this is all, pumping is on. Later we switch it off. And this is, I think, the next slide. So okay, we can actually, since we have everything momentum resolved, we can actually see how various modes, how they kind of evolve. So for example, this here, this is function of time. This is, for example, this is a logarithmic scale here. This is how the parametric instability appears. So we get in some momenta, you get a exponential growth of some modes which satisfy the condition of parametric resonance. And of course, there is this nice theory called S theory by this is the Russian made by some Russian community. They like to use S because it was maybe meant to be the boson analogon of BCS, but it didn't propagate too much. Anyway, in this S theory, you can actually calculate the slope of this instability, and it perfectly fits our numerics. But of course, S theory, eventually you get a saturation and some leveling off of the occupation. Right? At the same time, we looked at the uniform mode, so this is a k equals zero z component. So once you get a saturation of the parametric instability, the uniform mode starts to grow and also saturate. But it remains small. The uniform mode is always small, so the z component of the magnetization is only slightly reduced, but it's reduced. Okay, then we can look at the condensate. So I think the red line here is again the parametric instability. So once the parametric instability develops and it kind of levels off, this is then actually the k equals zero mode. So the mode at the minimum starts to shoot off and go to a much higher value than the highest value of the parametric instability. Yeah, I have 5 minutes. I'm almost done. And then this is like stochastic time evolution. We can do also like averaging over time. So we use some ergodic hypothesis. Then we see we get for the magnon mode, we get for the mode at the lowest lowest k vector, we get a very sharp peak, and it's in our numerical simulation it was limited only by the grid in momentum space we used. So we get really a sharp condensation in momentum space, similar to Bose-Einstein condensation, and we can describe this peak here by a quasi-equilibrium. It's still with pumping. Pumping is never switched off, but via this pumping, you get some quasi-equilibrium. You get a thermal part which has an effective chemical potential, but then we get this delta peak here in the middle, and this is the condensate. So this is what we call Radio-Jeans condensate.
Do you actually get a macroscopic occupation of single mode in your
calculation? Yeah, as long as we can, it's within our momentum resolution. It's a one mode.
Numerically, you can do whatever.
Yeah, we have a finite resolution. We can say within our resolution.
Why do you have a finite resolution?
Because we put it on the grid.
Yeah, but you discretize the modes. So you have a well-defined single mode.
Yeah, yeah, right. But within this discretization, it's condensed in a single mode. Yeah.
Yeah, in your numerical simulation.
Yeah.
That single mode gets microscopic occupation.
Yeah, that's what we get.
So, you're showing some kind of broad peak, but it's actually true delta function.
Yeah, yeah. It's a little bit broadened here, right? But we investigated the size dependence of this, and we are sure it's within our, within our resolution. It looks like a delta peak. Okay. Then we can also play another thing. We can switch off, for example, here we can switch off the pumping. So it's a stationary and non-equilibrium. They switch off the pumping and see how the condensate decays. There's also one experiment Burkhardt is doing in his group. And then we can actually see the time constant. So it's, again, a logarithmic plot. The time constant on which the condensate decays. And we can compare this with experiments, and indeed we get about 250 nanoseconds, and it completely agrees with what they see in the experiment. So we can also the decay of the mode we can describe. Okay, my time is over almost. Let me mention some open problems which we cannot handle so far. One thing we haven't looked at is a condensation pattern in real space, which I think we need bigger systems for that. So we are working on that, but the question is, what are the consequences of having two degenerate minima in momentum space? How does it condense then is there like a standing wave, or does it condense in one? We haven't been able to do this carefully and with our numerics, and this is one thing I think we believe we can solve in the next maybe 6 months or so. Then the role of quantum mechanics at low temperatures. I know in Kaiserslautern they are now planning to cool the system and maybe go to 10 Kelvin or so from room temperature and see quantum effects at low temperatures. But as far as I understand, I talked to Alexander Serger yesterday, They haven't done it yet. They had some technical problems of doing that. So, but of course, we are doing a classical description, so quantum effects, they are not included. So I don't know how to do that. Maybe one has to go back to a quantum Boltzmann equation, but this is more complicated than what we have done. And the other thing is, you know, this classical non-equilibrium phase transitions. This is a very interesting phenomenon. How do we classify this from the point of view of phase transitions? From the point of view of non-equilibrium phase transitions, is this something new? Is this known? What's the universality class of this? And I think this is an interesting topic. There is not much work on that, and this is interesting to look at in the future. Maybe one needs analytical methods and a better analytical understanding for that in order to make progress. Okay, and I guess it's 1 o'clock. Everybody's hungry, and let me stop here.
Sure. Okay, let's thank you.